morning. As we begin this memorial service for May Garces, I'd like to ask that if you haven't, you would turn off your cell phones or put them on vibrate so that they don't just go off when you don't want them to. And then I'd just like to thank you all on behalf of Mario and Mario Jr. and Olivia for being here. For everyone who's ever been through the pain, the agony, the suffering that goes on when you lose someone you love, having people come to be with them during that time means everything. And they know you have busy schedules. They know you had other plans for this day until this service was announced, and that you adjusted your schedule to be here. And so on behalf of them, I want to say thank you. That means everything. And with that, I'd like to ask that you would join with me in a word of prayer as we open our service. Father, our Heavenly Father, thank you for the hope that we have, the hope of eternity in Jesus Christ. Father, without that hope, I don't know, it just seems we would have to numb ourselves to the pain. But we, because of you, we grieve differently. Because we grieve with hope. And so, Lord, we ask your blessing upon this service today, and that you would be honored, and that it would be just what May would want. In Jesus' name, amen. I was sharing just a few minutes ago, I love love. Love is, we all need it. We all love to experience it. And when we do, there's nothing like it. But there is a problem with loving, and that's losing. When you lose someone you love, it hurts so much. And sometimes we don't want it to hurt, so we kind of wish we could just back off the love. But there's nothing worse than losing someone you could have experienced love with, and you didn't. When there's been a distance between people who ought to love one another, and so when one is lost, the other doesn't experience the emotions of grief. Because you see, grief is a good thing. And I want you to know that today. I want you to know that you're grieving, however you're grieving, it's a good thing, because it's evidence of relationship, it's evidence of love. You say, but it's so deep within. That's because the love was so deep within. Mario, I think of you and your life mate, now with Jesus. It's interesting. It was time for her to be with him, but he's not finished with you here. He's got work for you. And she would want you to be involved in what he's calling you to do. For Mario Jr. and Olivia, your mom. I didn't get to know your mom, but I met her at a critical time of her life. Mario, you weren't there, and Olivia, you were. We were in the hospital. And I've got to share this with you, because the day before, she could not get out of bed. In fact, the doctors had said, we are at the end, and you need to make decisions about resuscitation and all of those medical things that go on. But when I came that next day, she was sitting up, and we talked. And she smiled. Stayed awake the whole time. Olivia said she might fall asleep. She never fell asleep. And then I said, "May we want to pray for you." And I knew, and I hope you'll understand what I'm saying, I knew that she wasn't very tall. But when she stood up for the prayer, all of her 4'11", she stood up tall and closed her eyes and began to pray to her Lord. And it was a powerful moment in that hospital room. Truly a woman of faith. And so that just means for the both of you, her heart's desire, for all of you, for your lovely bride, Mario, for all of you, Denise, she wants to spend eternity with all of you. We'll talk more about that. But she's got plans to see you again. And so, we've gathered today to just remember. But before we go on, there's a song that the family would like to have played. Perhaps you've heard it. If you haven't, would you listen to the words? They are very powerful. The song is called 10,000.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawn. Time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. Bless You, time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then His holy name, sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship your holy name. Come on, bless the Lord, oh, my soul. Oh, my soul, worship His holy name. Worship your holy name, Lord, I worship your holy name. Sing like never. Worship your holy name, Jesus, I will worship your holy name, worship your holy name.
That's exactly what May was doing as her end drew near. She was worshiping His holy name. She was quite a lady, but nobody knew her better than her husband. And Mario is going to come and do his best to try and share with us.
Good morning to everyone here this morning, and happy that many of my friends and relatives came here to the service this morning. Many of you guys travel from Los Angeles. My brother came from Puerto Rico, and I really will appreciate that very much. Some of you might be familiar with. So you might not be familiar with me. I'm Mario Garces, my husband of 39 years. Let me begin by stating a few words about my wife, May. We live a long life together. And it's really unfortunate that she passes away after a brief battle with cancer. She was too young to leave us. She was a loving mother for 37 years to our son and daughter Mario and Olivia. She was also a very caring and loving wife. I remember when we first met in Taiwan back in 1972, the memory still of those days still clear in my mind. She was so beautiful. And I remember her first warm smile on me. We connected immediately. It was like love at first sight. From that point on, we spent our time together visiting museums and coffee houses and sightseeing all over the island of Taiwan. Those were beautiful days. To my surprise, she cooked delicious chicken curry for me one day, and the rest is history. I asked her to marry me immediately. She She was a good, she cooks real good. I think she knew that the way to a man is to his stomach. I asked her one day, can you cook rice and beans? And she laughed saying, I can do better than that. And I said, okay, man, okay. Her biggest attribute was that she was a giver. My wife was a giver. She loves to buy things for others and give away. I remember years ago when we were stationed in Yokota Air Base in Japan, I saw 10 rice cookers in the house. I said, mate, we got 10 rice cookers in here. What's going on? And she said, well, you know, your brother, your sister, your mother, they all need a rice cooker. Those guys use water down there. That's not healthy. That's not healthy. So I said, well, yeah, that's good. So we mail all these rice cookers back to our families and friends, and they respond back. Man, this is great. I love this rice cooker. So she was thinking ahead. We married in October 1974, and I started a family. We raised my son and a daughter, Mario and Olivia. And I am very proud of them. In the last 2 months of married life, Mario and Olivia were with me at the bedside in the hospital, telling her how much we love her. She passed away knowing that we care about her and that we love her very much. May was very successful during her 22-year career as a federal employee with the Department of Defense. She was well organized and very skillful at her work. She was a final analyst. Her work ethic never disappointed anyone. She got the work done. Everyone who knew her, anyone who knew her well, loved her. On her spare time, May loved to cook, and her culinary skill gains are some of the best in town. She enjoyed going to movies, shopping, Macy's, and travel around the state of California with me. In April 2005, I think this is probably one of the highlights of her career, she got an assignment, a promotion assignment to Bolling Air Force Base in Washington, D.C. And I asked her, May, you know, we have been doing little trips here and there in California. This is going to be across the nation. And she responded, yeah, I'm looking forward to see this great country and the challenge of a new job. I mean, she was never afraid of anything. And she never disappointed anyone. Even though she had some hobbies and skills, her true passion in life was her family, especially her grandchildren, Joshua and Jada. Many people will surely miss her, especially us, her family, and close friends. I know that May's memory will live on the heart of all the people that she touched. And I would say that I am a better person because of her. So May, my love, sleep well. Hope we see each other again.
Mario Jr. is going to come and share his thoughts about it.
I haven't had the pleasure to meet. My name is Mario Jr. And I want to thank you again for coming today. It truly does mean a lot to my family to see you all here showing your support. You know, for a long time, the definition of family for me consisted of my parents and my sister. That's it. That feeling was probably attributed to being part of a military family. And while it allowed for great experiences living around the world, at the same time, it came with sacrifices. And one of those sacrifices was not really having the opportunity to forge bonds with family beyond my parents and sister. My point is that seeing you all here today, taking the time to pay your respects, being here for me, my dad, my sister allows me to feel that we're not alone. It's comforting knowing that we've got great friends to lean on, and there really is family we can count on. If anyone here were to ask me to describe my mom in one word, to me that word would be perseverance. My mom, without a doubt, was the type of person that made the most of any opportunity that came her way and did her best no matter what the circumstances were. When it came to raising a family, regardless of what me, my sister, or my dad put her through, she persevered with her love and intention and made sure our well-being was her utmost priority. In my opinion, one way she always expressed her love was how great she fed us. Her attention to making her meals as big and as delicious as possible never failed. In fact, one narrative that I will miss between my mom and dad kind of went like this. So here's my dad in a stern voice. "May, what are we doing? Are we cooking for an army? No. All you're gonna do is waste food." And so here's my mom's reply, and it's in a dismissive kind of tone. "Daddy, shut up and eat." And sincerely, this went on all the time. So, you know, in my mom's professional life, she was determined to be her best. And while I didn't personally witness her accomplishments during her career, my mom proudly told me every chance she got. And in retrospect, you know, looking back, I now realize that, you know, while she was excited to tell me about the things she did, about the promotion she took, she was at the same time illustrating to me the importance of hard work, determination, and being the best you can be. And without a doubt, those values live with me to this day because of her. Growing up, I always had a sense of security knowing my mom was there for me. In my early teens, when I was aspiring to be a professional skateboarder, even though I lacked the talent, I knew that it was not if I sprained my ankle or got hurt, but when I sprained my ankle, I got hurt, I could count on her to come get me. And I'll share one fond memory of her always supporting me, and that's when I was out with my buddies, and I of course sprained my ankle for probably the eighth time. I called her up, and she left work to come get me, and there was no denying that she was mad when she pulled up, but I think once I got up and started hobbling towards the car, I could just see her face transition from being, you know, from her frown to a smirk. I mean, she just couldn't stay mad at me, and you know, her picking me up her picking me up wasn't the end of it. She still took me to the hospital. She still waited with me, and she never made me feel like I was a burden. And so that unconditional love she had for me is something I'll never forget and always will miss. So Mom, thank you for doing all you did for me. Thank you for everything you taught me. Thank you for showing me the meaning of perseverance, and more importantly, thank you for the love you gave me.
You know, it's interesting. Sometimes you meet someone through the eyes of others, and meeting May through the eyes of the two of you, I'm wondering why you didn't invite me over for dinner. It seemed to be all about food. Olivia's written something, and she's not sure she can read it, but Lisa's going to come. And are you going to come up too? Come too. You just come stand here with your friend. Lisa will read it, and you come. I'm making her do this.
I'm very happy to see so many friends, coworkers, and family here today to pay their respects to my mother, May Garces. I would like to thank all of you for coming to celebrate my mother's wonderful life. Seeing so many of you would have made her so happy and very appreciative. For those of you who don't know me, I am Olivia, her favorite and only daughter. Maybe that's why I was her favorite. This has been a very hard year for my family and me. My mother was a very strong, independent, and determined woman. And to see her weak, frail, and ultimately helpless was very difficult for my family and me. Yet, I find comfort in the fact that she's in a place where there is no pain and no suffering. She's now in heaven, a place with peace and beauty beyond our imagination, where she can be her independent, strong, and good-humored self with our Savior, Jesus Christ. For those of you who don't know my mother, maybe a few of my more memorable stories about her struggles, life experiences, and achievements will help you understand who she was and why she's so special. My mother came from a poor and modest upbringing in Taiwan. Despite losing her father at a young age and enduring many struggles and difficulties, her resilience and determination allowed her to pursue her education and obtain her accounting degree. My mother then fortunately met my father, love you dad, while he was stationed in Taiwan, and it was the beginning of a remarkable love story. Despite a cultural and language barrier, they were still able to fall deeply in love with one another. To no surprise, my father was captivated and enamored by my mother, who was a young, beautiful, caring woman, and not to mention an excellent cook. There is truth in the saying that the way to a man's heart is through his stomach. Mom was such a great cook that friends often wondered why she didn't start her own restaurant. Personally, I think she would have outcooked many of the Iron Chefs on the Food Network. After finding his love, my father returned to the States, but not without making certain my mom would soon follow. My mother's journey to join my father in the U.S. was an exceptional story of determination and courage. Mom spoke no English, yet with her persistence and feisty nature, she was able to get through our chaotic and crazy airports and find her way into the arms of my father. They married and began their lives together. My parents then had my older brother Mario, and shortly thereafter, their beautiful daughter Olivia, me. We had an adventurous yet somewhat challenging childhood. We traveled to many countries during my father's military career, and despite this instability, my mother was always the family's backbone caring for us. When we finally concluded our travels and settled down in California, my mother obtained a job for the military as an accountant. Again, to no surprise, she quickly climbed her way up to the high-ranking position. She recently retired from the job she loved, only to unfortunately face the most difficult battle of her life, stage 4 lung cancer in a healthy non-smoker, something unimaginable. Yet she faced this battle with an unyielding will to fight and tenacity. I remember 2 weeks before her passing, her oncologist asked if she wanted to continue fighting and carry on with her chemotherapy. Without hesitation, my mom made a fist and said, "Bring it on." She was a determined and hardworking woman with numerous beautiful qualities and attributes. She lived her life for her family and always stayed positive. It is impossible not to respect her struggles and accomplishment. I'm very proud and inspired by you, Mom. She not only inspired me, but others. She was perceived by those who knew her as an honest, loyal, and caring person. One of her remarkable qualities can be exemplified by her treatment of others. My mother would donate the sick hours she accrued at work to colleagues who were ill and in need of the hours. She was unselfish and generous. Mother was also a caring and loving grandmother. She lived for and through her kids and grandkids. There was never a birthday, Christmas, or special event in her grandchildren's life that she didn't spoil them to the extreme. She received pleasure in seeing the happiness and smiles of her grandkids. The love for her family and her love of life showed itself in many spectacular ways. She was a remarkable mother and person. The exceptional qualities of my mother became ever so evident during her last year while battling with her illness. I saw her determination, strong will, love for God, and life shine through during her struggle with cancer. Nurses and doctors were astonished that a small 4 foot 11 inch Asian woman with a strong accent could be so strong and resilient. She optimistically accepted and endured all her treatments, including the chemotherapy, which is not easy, with a strong will and positive outlook. She remained focused on overcoming her illness and never on her suffering. Yet she trusted that no matter the outcome of her fight with cancer, that God's will be done. She continued to worry about our future and us until her very last breath. I could go on about my mother and how she inspired and amazed me, but I think I gave you a small glimpse of my mother through the window of her life. I know many of you have your own fond stories and memories of my mother. I will miss her tremendously, and I will always cherish the time and memories I had with her. Mother was always there when I needed her. To me, she was the most loving and caring person in the world. I want us all to remember and celebrate her life. Even though she is gone, her memories will live in our hearts forever. I love you, Mom.
No doubt the most difficult thing that man faces in life is death. Because death is the unknown. In fact, when we lose somebody we love, we get confronted with that age-old question. It's a question we don't really discuss much, unless we're in one of those discussions with a friend or with a group of friends about life and purpose for life. Because when we talk about the purpose for life, we can't help but come to that place when life ends. And then the question comes up, what then? When life ends, well, is there another dimension where life continues? Or is death an end in itself? To live from birth, no matter how many years, Mario, as you shared, she was just too young to go. And by the way, I believe that when we're in love with someone, they're always 59 years, and then she's gone. And there are some who would say, that's it. It's over. In fact, when we go to National Cemetery later this afternoon, there's markers all over that cemetery that shout that death wins and that it's over. But can that be all there is? As so many have said, surely there must be more. Probably the first book that was really ever put together in scriptures, the first story anyway, would have been the story of Job. And he asks that age-old question, if a man dies or when a man dies, will he live again? And I think it's an important question. And the problem is that because we can't enter into that realm, then we can't by ourselves come up with the answer. But I think the answer needs to be found. The Bible talks a lot about death and life. In fact, there was a funeral. A man had died, too young. His two sisters were upset. In fact, when he was sick, his name was Lazarus, they had sent for Jesus because he was the miracle worker. They were friends. They sent for him and said, the one you love is sick. And when we hear that, we immediately, when we have a loved one that's sick, we run to the hospital. We run to their side. I mean, that's how we are. That's our makeup. And if anybody would run to someone's side, it would be Jesus, but he didn't. In fact, after he heard that Lazarus was sick, he just continued doing what he was doing. And in fact, finally, he said to his disciples, let's go to Bethany. Bethany was just a suburb of Jerusalem. He said, let's just go to Bethany. And he said to them that Lazarus was asleep. And they said, if he's asleep, then why should we go? Because there are people in Jerusalem that want you dead. And then Jesus looked at them and he said, Lazarus has died. So he shows up in Bethany. And Martha, one of the two sisters, she was the outspoken one. You knew what she thought. She wore her emotions on her sleeve. Her sister was more contemplative. Her name was Mary. But Martha, And so she left the home where they were grieving. Jewish custom, Jewish tradition, you stayed in the home for 30 days. In fact, there were people that would come and grieve with you. They could be strangers, but they weren't really strangers because they had experienced what you were experiencing. They could relate. They could identify. But Martha, she broke all tradition and custom, and she ran out to meet Jesus. And again, she wore emotions on her sleeve. She said, if you'd have been here, my brother wouldn't have died. In other words, you could have done something. And I don't know if you've ever done this. I would suppose you have, where you say something and you wish you could have the words back. Well, that was what Martha kind of did. And then she said, but now I know that whatever you ask of God, he'll give it to you. And Jesus looked at her. She said, your brother will rise again. And she said, well, and she believed in the resurrection. She believed in life after death. And she said, I know he'll rise on the last day. And then Jesus proclaimed a truth to her that was and is the most remarkable truth that could ever be proclaimed. Or he was a liar, a sham, and deserved to die. Because what he said instills a hope in people that is beyond any hope anyone could have. Listen to the words of Jesus Christ to this woman in her grief. He said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me, and then he said this, he said, will never die. Wait a minute. Everyone has an appointment with death. We all know, again, we don't sit around the table at dinner and talk about, hey, so when's your appointment with death? We just don't do that. But we all know we have one. Every one of us will be at a service one day that's much like this one, except we would be where May is. If you believe in me, you'll never die. And then he said to Martha, do you believe what I've told you? She said, yes, I do. If you know the story, he went to the tomb and called forth Lazarus, and he came forth from the tomb after being buried for 4 days. But he would die again. It was more than just bringing Lazarus from the tomb. Again, listen to the words. I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Now, as Jesus' life story went on, a few weeks, maybe a couple of months later, he was back in Jerusalem for the Passover. He was arrested, and he was sentenced to die, and he was crucified on a cross. In fact, the Bible tells us he breathed his last, bowed his head, and gave up the ghost. He gave up his spirit. He was gone, and they buried him. What about his claims? If you believe in me, you'll never die. And death had won, or had it. Because 3 days later, Jesus Christ did what no man who ever lived, including every religious leader who founded every great religion in the world, he did what no one else did. He defeated death. He conquered the grave. He rose from the dead. And he's alive. And he proved what he had said was true. Now, along the way, May was confronted with those same words. Do you believe this? And she said, yes, I believe. In fact, on and off, because they traveled so much, but on and off, they attended the church where I pastored for 10 years or so. Yes, I believe. That day in the hospital, as she stood to her feet, and she and I were eye to eye. And it was a moment, in a sense, from my perspective, I don't know about hers, from my perspective, nobody else was in the room. It was me and her. And she confessed her faith in Christ in an amazing way. So what does that all mean? Just this. Well, the Apostle Paul, in understanding that Jesus had conquered the grave, the Apostle Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, he said, "For we know that if our earthly house, this tent, we know that if it is destroyed," and he spoke of this earthly house, these bodies that each of us dwell in, as tents. A tent isn't a permanent structure. It's a temporary structure. We don't want to live in a tent. We go on vacation in a tent till you're a little older, and then you don't even want a tent. You'll say, you know, give me a motor home. And the best part, if you ever did tent camp, the best part of tent camping, besides all the enjoyable memories, was when you came home. And you turned the corner, and there was your house. It was still standing, and your shower was still running, and your bed was still there waiting for you. We're out of the tent, packing away. Paul spoke of these bodies as tents. He says, we know that if our earthly house, this tent is destroyed. When I was with May in the hospital, her tent was giving out quickly. It was in the process, we're all in the process of destruction, but hers was close to that place of destruction, a place where it could no longer communicate to us who she is. Paul said, we know that if our earthly house, this tent, is destroyed, we know that we have a building, not a tent, we have a building from God. He said, it's a house. It's not made with hands. It's eternal in the heavens. He said, we who were in this tent, we groan. She was groaning a lot in those last days. We groan, we're burdened. He said, it's not because we want to be unclothed. It's not because we want to be floating around without an abode, but we want to be further clothed. And then he put it like this. He said, that mortality, we are all mortal, right? We all know that. We all have that appointment down the road. We're mortal. And every day when the obituaries are posted, the shout is, death is won. We walk to that cemetery today, and there are those markers, and we read them. I don't know, I'm sure you do. You read the markers. There's the name. There's maybe a comment. I don't know what would be on May's marker. It'd be so, an amazing wife. A persistent mother that just went for it. I don't know, but maybe it's just going to say, May Garces, an Iron Chef. I don't know. But we have a short little statement that we put on a marker that's supposed to sum up their life. And then we put a date of birth. We put a date of death. And do you ever notice that dash in between? That dash sums up, for May, 59 years of living. And we walk in the cemetery and we see marker after marker after marker after marker after marker of people who have been laid to rest. Death! It shouts, I won. The Apostle Paul said, we want to move into the house that God has prepared for us. And then he said that mortality may be swallowed up by life. Paul said, because of Jesus, life wins. The Bible, Paul says, later on he says, to be absent from this body is to what? To be present with the Lord. In other words, this is her tent. She's not in there. She's present with the Lord. What does that mean? It means she didn't die. Oh yes, she breathed her last here, but the moment she breathed her last here, she breathed her first in heaven. I know that's true because Jesus conquered the grave. I know it's true. She moved from her tent to her house. That's what May has done. She's moved. She's had an address change. here's the problem. Only those who have that house that God has built for them will see her again, because we can't go to heaven in these tents. As someone once said, there's no tent camping in heaven. I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, yet shall he live. And whoever, that includes every one of us, whoever lives and believes in me will never die. And then he looked at Martha and he said, do you believe? You see, Mary, she said, yes, I believe. The question is now, do you? Do you believe? I could tell from that day I talked to her that the most important one in her life was not her husband or her children or her grandchildren. It was Jesus. They came in a close second, but it was Jesus. And so I present to you today that May Garcia has graduated. She's no longer suffering. She's no longer in pain. There's no more tears. And her heart's desire is that she spend eternity with you. Yes, there is an answer to that age-old question. If a man dies, will he live again? Jesus Christ proved it when he rose from the dead. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, I thank you for her faith in you. Sure makes it easier to do this service knowing she's with you. What a message of hope. Our hope is centered in you. Oh, Father, I thank you that you're the God of all comfort. You understand our grief and the journey of it, and all the way, all along the way, you're there comforting us. We thank you for that. We thank you for this service, for the memories. And may we rehash those memories forever, because they're wonderful. We thank you for it, in Jesus' name. We'd like to conclude our service with Amazing Grace.
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. But I'm